Jason, I think you made it into Koyuk before Lance, and Lance, you came upon Scott Janssen's team without Scott Janssen. Tell us what happened.
Yeah, that was, well, obviously unexpected. I was, you know, we were just cruising along, and, you know, there's nothing out there. It's wide open, but there's a lot of pressure ridges and just big ice chunks all over the place, you know, and as boring as it is, I was still out there looking around trying to, you know, make shapes out of the ice, but whatever, just trying to entertain myself, kind of. And I was glancing over, and I see what appeared to be a tree. That's what my first thought was. It was just a big tree stump, which didn't make sense because there were no tree stumps anywhere else. And it was fairly small. A dog team, you could kind of make it out if they were even laying there because it stretched out 14 dogs or however many, you know. But this wasn't the case. It was all about a 8-foot round obstacle. And so I saw it, I glanced at it, didn't register. But as I was going by it, and now it's 200 or 300 yards off the trail, so it's not real visible. Mm-hmm. But as I was going by it, I glanced over there again, and I noticed the handlebar and a ski pole sticking up. So I stopped immediately, and Brian Wilmhurst was right there, and so was Chuck Schaefer. And I told Brian, I think that's a dog team over there. And he kind of chuckled. He said, why would it be over there? I said, I don't know, but I got to go check it out. So I anchored my dogs down, and Brian stood there and watched them while I walked over there. And as soon as I got there, my heart just started pounding. I found 10 dogs in a ball. One was loose 50, 60 yards away by himself. I thought that dog had passed. He looked dead to me. And the scary thing was there was no driver. There was no foot tracks. There was no sign of anything. So I started looking for the tracking devices, which were gone. And then I really started panicking because I seen his sleeping bag was out, and half of it was stuffed in the sled. The other half was just kind of laying there. There was no ice hook, you know, tethering him down, which told me that this team had gotten away, and, you know, where's the driver? We started frantically looking around, looking behind icebergs and whatnot, and couldn't find any sign of him. So there was no way in hell I was going to leave that team sitting there. And once I started untangling them, Brian walked over there, helped me get them all untangled. But what did we do with them? You know, he had 11 dogs, and I wasn't going to leave them there. There was no way I was going to leave them there, musher or not, you know. And Chuck, he had been walking around again, still looking for any sign. And we knew for sure he was laying face down behind some iceberg somewhere. We just couldn't figure out which iceberg, you know. And at that time, it had subsided a little bit. It was still cold, but the wind was still blowing a little bit. And they asked me, well, what do you want to do? Just anchor him down, we'll go into town. I said, I ain't anchoring him down. I'm taking that team to town. Well, how are you going to do that? And I said, watch this. So I had a single leader. I took that spare tug line, and I hooked my leader hook on that snap, and then I took my ice hook and wrapped around his handlebar, and then tethered it there. So I rode the second my team on the second sled and had his in between mine and I drove 21 dogs into Koyuk. With, I think it's still probably the biggest team in the race.
Have you ever done anything like that before?
No.
Just improvise.
Not like that. Well, yeah, exactly. You adapt and overcome. But like I said, there was no way in hell I was going to leave that team out there. I didn't know how long it had been there. I didn't care how long it had been there. But I knew it had been there a little while because when I broke out a bag of fish, they just about took my hand off eating. So I knew they had been there a while. I could tell they had been there just from the knot that they were in. And, you know, where they were laying was all kind of melted down, the snow would blow over them. So, you know, I mean, all kinds of things go through your head in those situations. I, you know, I consider Scott a friend. And my very first thought was, if I get to Koyuk and he's not there, it's confirming what I think I already know, and that he's out there on the ice somewhere. And I'm going with whoever it is to go look for him. It didn't matter. I mean, I'm going with these people to find my friend. you know. And when we got there, luckily he had already been there and he had, you know, been in the clinic and whatnot. But it still was appalling to me that he got rescued and they left the dogs out there. It's, to me, that's unacceptable. You know,
The rescue crew said they told me they couldn't find the dogs.
Which is probably true.
Yeah, well.
But where did they find Scott?
Where did they find Scott? You know? If you found Scott, you were obviously at the dogs at one point. Why didn't you send that same crew back?
Yeah.
You know, I spoke to the two rescue man and woman there, and they said they searched for over an hour and a half for the dogs, and then just gave up because there was no team.
Yeah.
Well, you don't just give up and leave 11 dogs laying there helpless.
I heard.
You know, I don't agree with how it all went down. I don't know exactly how it went down, but it's, again, dogs first.
Yeah. I mean, what do you guys, have seen this? I mean, we saw this last year with a guy like Jeff King who, you know, he's right at the front and he ends up getting weathered out of a finish. Last year, Hugh Neff out of Unalakleet, something similar. As mushers, what responsibility do you have to set up camp or find a way to survive until the weather clears? And what responsibility do you think the trail committee has or the volunteers have to offer assistance and help you get to safety?
I don't agree with the tracking devices. If you want to track us and watch us race, that's wonderful. But to be able to push a button to come get saved, I disagree totally with them. That's my personal opinion. You better be prepared to spend the night on the ice or in a snow cave or build a shelter. You better be savvy enough to make it on your own. And if you're not, then you have no business doing this. You know, you can't rely on volunteers to come save your ass off the ice. You can't, it's not up to the committee to make sure that you know your skills. You know, you go to qualifying races to make sure you're capable of taking care of 12 to 16 dogs and yourself. They do a report card. You don't know what is going to be handed to you.
There's not a qualifying race out there that makes you qualified to run the Iditarod in these kind of temperatures and these kind of winds. And, you know, and fending for yourself, it's a little different when you're sitting out in the middle of Norton Sound or Galton Bay or something and there's 40-mile-an-hour winds at 20 below and there is nowhere to go. You know, I don't know the situation that Scott was in. I can assume it was similar to what we were going through when we left Shaktulik. We sat in Shaktulik for 18 hours waiting for the wind to die down a little bit. And other teams had went through. Other teams made it. We weren't willing to put ourselves and our dog teams in that position for a personal satisfaction or a better placement in the standings for $1,000. I mean, are you kidding me? You know? It's just not justifiable. So we sat, you know, we left Shaktulik after being there damn near a day, went 13 miles and sat there another half a day, or a little more than half a day. And when we did go, we're like, well, we've been here long enough. We should at least try this. None of us really wanted to go. Chuck Schaefer was there as well. And, you know, Chuck, he's from Kotzebue. He knows all about wind and cold. And he's like, I don't think so, you know. Well, those aren't real encouraging kind of words from a guy that lives in this stuff, you know. So, you know, luckily it wasn't as bad as it had been. And we managed to make it over to Koyuk, but you're putting yourself, you're very vulnerable in those situations, you know? And for us, when we left Shaktulik, we loaded our sleds like we was going on a month-long camping trip and everything we needed to be comfortable and plenty of dog food for a month, you know? We knew what we was getting ourselves into, and even as challenging as it might be, we still had to have you couldn't have much doubt. The dogs would feed off of that, and they might just leave you sitting out there, you know. And I think a lot of those kind of things happen. You know, Scott might have been in that situation. Maybe he was doubting himself going across it. I don't know. I can't speak for him, but no doubt about it, everybody had something in this race that they'll never forget, you know, and we're no exception.